So hi guys, a warm welcome to you all. I welcome you to the series called RBI 24/7 day 148. So guys, as you all must be knowing that in this series we discuss 5 questions about finance and economics that can be of use to you if you are preparing for competitive exams, right? So before moving ahead with the session, a brief introduction about your mentor. Guys, I have done my graduation from Sri Guru Gobind Singh College of Commerce, Delhi University, and post-graduation from Delhi School of Economics. I'm a JRF holder in Commerce and Management as well. So guys, this was a brief introduction about your mentor Mansi Anand for this series. And now we would move ahead to the question. And before moving ahead with the question, I would like to tell you to do the customary thing. So if you are a new entrant here and you are watching our video for the very first time, then don't forget to go to this button and subscribe to our channel. It can help you to stay in touch with us. And don't forget to press this bell icon which is flashing on the screen. It can get you updated regarding all notification, all new videos of all the mentors that come up, right? And after that, you can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries, and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. So guys, since we are talking about query, we get a lot of queries that is the series enough for current affairs. So guys, apart from RBI 247, we run PIP 247 and government scheme series, which is covered by Manish sir, and Neha ma'am also takes up the morning tales in which she discusses the current affairs, daily current affairs, right? So you can also watch these series, and they are getting a really good response from the students. And now I would like to move straight away to the question number one. So here is your question number one, and this question says, a dash refers to the tendency of markets to value a diversified group of businesses and assets at less than the sum of its parts, right? So this has been in news in regard to a case that we have partly discussed in our previous session, right? So moving ahead to the solution for this question, and the solution says that the correct answer is option A. Option A means a holding company discount. So the name in itself tells you the discount which is on the holding company is known as a holding company discount, or it is also known as the conglomerate discount. So guys, I think we all must be familiar with this term, conglomerate. So a conglomerate is a group of companies. So you can understand it as an umbrella company or a parent company which has a lot of companies under it. For example, let's say Tata. If we talk about Tata, there are many things that Tata manufactures. Tata makes salt, it makes cars, so Tata Steel. So there are a lot and lot of variety of products that Tata deals in, right? Under the name of different companies, right? So we can say that Tata is a conglomerate, right? So now, what is this holding company discount? So guys, you know that whenever investors, they have to take any decisions regarding whether to invest in a company or not to invest, they value the company, or they try to measure that what is the potential lying there in the company or the future growth potential, that whether I should invest in this or not. So if you remember, in one of our previous sessions we discussed about SOPP method, that is sum of the parts method. It is a method to value a conglomerate. So whenever you have to value a company like Tata, under which there are so many companies, then you can use this SOTP method. So briefly, SOTP means trying to find out the value of a conglomerate using the sum of values of all the subsidiary companies. So if you want to discuss it in detail, you can watch that video by asking for its link in the comments, right? So SOTP method to find the value of a holding company, of a conglomerate company. Now this holding company discount concept, it says that whenever we value a conglomerate using SOTP method, using the value of its underlying subsidiary companies, in that case usually what happens is market values the sum of subsidiary at a higher rate than the entire value of this conglomerate, right? So market sees the entire value of this conglomerate as lesser than the sum of its parts, right? So let's say if there are four companies under it, for first they have a valuation of 200 crore, for the other one the valuation of 300 crore, 200 for the third and 400 for the fourth. So that gives you a total of 1000 crore, right? So this should be the total according to the SOTP method. So if there are four companies under Tata, the valuation of the holding company or the conglomerate company should be 1000 crore, which is the sum of all these four subsidiaries that Tata is having, right? But in practical sense or in real sense, what happens is that the subsidiaries might be valued at this valuation, but the entire valuation of Tata is going to be less than 1000 crore. It might be at 800 crores. So this difference of 200 is the holding company discount, that is market valuing a conglomerate lesser than the sum of its subsidiaries, right? I hope now you are clear with this concept. Here you can see some more information. So conglomerate discount refers to the tendency of market, right? We have discussed it. So conglomerate by definition owns a controlling stake in a number of smaller companies. Conglomerate discount occurs when the multiple divisions are not performing as well as the overall conglomerate. So there might be one company under this conglomerate which is performing really great, but there might be others which are not performing as good as the one performing the best. So as a result, market participants might apply a discount to the value of conglomerate. So if some of the companies are not performing good, the responsibility might go to the conglomerate, meaning that its earnings or profits are discounted at a lower value. SOTP found out by adding an estimate of the intrinsic value of each subsidiary and then subtracting the conglomerate's capitalization. So they are saying first find out the value by SOTP and then find out the value of conglomerate. Since conglomerate valuation comes out lesser than SOTP, you can subtract conglomerate's valuation from the SOTP valuation, right? So there might be many reasons behind it. See, usually what happens is a conglomerate is a managing company which is managing so many subsidiaries. So it has huge overhead expenses and it has to manage the conflict of interest among so many companies. So these are some factors which affect its valuation, right? So the underlying companies might be performing good, but conglomerate might be having high overhead expenses of managing these companies, or there might be some conflict between amongst them, right? So moving ahead to the next question for today, and here is your second question, and this question says select the correct statement regarding yield gap, right? Moving ahead to the solution, the solution says that the correct option is D. So guys, D means smaller the yield gap, lower the equity yield is compared to government bonds indicating that equity is overpriced. So just forget about it for a minute. First, let's talk about yield gap. Okay. So yield gap, simply if you want to find out yield gap, take the return which is available to investors on investing into equity and then subtract the return that they get on investing in bonds. Basically, when you subtract the yields of both, the reward that the investor is getting on equity and the reward that the investor is getting on bonds, the difference between them is called the yield gap, right? Now, usually it is positive because the reward on equity is higher than bonds, right? Now they are saying, let's come back to the, as you can see here, this says, this was the correct option, Option D. So the smaller the yield gap, lower is the equity yield compared to government bonds. So smaller the yield gap. So they are saying that the difference between this is small, that means they are close to each other. That means the reward on investing in, if you invest into stocks and if you invest into bonds, you are probable to get some similar amount, right? So there is not much difference between the two. That means the reward on equity is somehow near to the reward on bonds. That is why this difference is small. So if this difference is small, that means equity is providing you a reward which is not very much higher than the bond, right? So the difference between them is low. See here, the smaller the yield gap, the lower the equity yield is compared to government bonds, right? Indicating that equity is overpriced. Now, since equity is not providing you with a very high reward as compared to government bonds, that is why they are saying equity is overpriced. Guys, this is just, see, this yield gap, this is just an indicating tool. So, the results out of it are not bound to be 100% or 10% accurate, but this is just an indicator which helps the investors to take decision. So simply they are saying, if the difference between them is not large, that means equity is overpriced because it is not providing a very high yield as compared to government bonds, right? So this is the correct option, right? So yield gap, ratio of dividend of yield on equity as compared to yield on long-term government bonds. Basically comparing the two, either you can find it by subtracting or you can take the ratio of them, right? Yield gap is calculated to determine whether equity is underpriced or overpriced compared to government bonds. Now if we reverse the situation, let's say the gap between this is really high, that means equity is providing you a return which is much higher than that of bonds. So this is equity's return and this is bonds return. So you see, it is providing you with a much better return. That means now it is good to invest in equity because the yield is very high, and that means equity is underpriced since it is providing a higher yield as compared to government bonds, right? So we can also reverse the situation to find out whether it is underpriced, equity is underpriced or overpriced as compared to government bonds. Basically, it is a measure that compares the two types of investment. Now coming to the reverse yield gap. Reverse yield gap was asked by one of you in the comments. So I hope now you watch it and your doubts get clear regarding this. Now see, I told you that this gap is positive because the reward on equity is higher than the reward on bonds, right? But if it turns negative anyhow, then the negative yield gap is called the reverse yield gap. Now we are just reversing the two. As you can see, is the amount by which yield on bond exceeds the yield on equity. So if we reverse it, it is going to become reverse yield gap, which means the excess of rewards on bonds over excess of rewards on equity. So this is your reverse yield gap. Other words, the amount by which interest on loans and bonds exceeds the cost of equity, right? So it is cheaper to raise money through equity as compared to bonds, right? So this was about yield gap. I hope now you are clear about it. Moving ahead to the next question. Here is your next question for today, which says, select the correct statements about social development bonds. Right, four statements given to you. You have to select the correct statement. Let's see what are the answers. The answer is option A. Option A means statement 1 and 4 are the correct ones. So 1 correct, 4 correct, right? So social impact bonds, the name itself tells you its meaning.
See, social impact bonds are definitely bonds, but not very likely of bonds. They are bonds which through which money is raised for a specific purpose. Let's say if government wants to build up a school for underprivileged children, but the government is not having money. Now, what they think of is, let's ask people for money, right? So we issue them bonds in return, we take their money. So issuing bonds to them and taking their money in return, right? Now using this money, government builds the school, and when this school earns the profit which goes to government, government gives it back to the people who have provided the bonds to government. Sorry, to whom bonds have been issued to by the government. Right, so very simple. So यहाँ पे आप देख सकते हो बहुत ही simple फंडा है. जैसे usually bonds में होता है, what we do, what companies do is they issue bonds. When they make money, they return that profit to the people to whom the securities have been issued. But the only difference here is the bond is being used, the money raised through bond is being used for a particular purpose which is going to have an impact on the society. So social development bonds or social impact bonds, they are known by many names, right? So I hope the concept is clear. But I just told you that they are not very likely of bonds. They have characteristics which are somehow different than that of bonds, although they are called bonds. So they do not provide a fixed rate of return. So when companies issue bonds, they usually provide a fixed rate of return to their to the bondholders. But here there is no fixed rate of return. If the school makes money, people who have lent money to government, they get money, they get some return back. But let's say this venture fails and government is not able to make any money through this school, then in that case, these people are going to get nothing or a very small amount depending on how much money government makes from that venture. Right, so there is no fixed rate of return. That is why statement 2 is incorrect. 1 is correct. Repayment is done irrespective of success of the projects for which funds are being raised. I just told you this is not the case. The repayment is done only if the venture for which the money had to be used is successful. So this is the correct option, option 4, that they are offered for a fixed term. So they can be like 5 years, 10 years, so they are offered for a fixed term. But repayment is not guaranteed. So this is one characteristic of social impact bonds, that they are very high risk securities because there is no guarantee of repayment, no fixed return. So although they are called bonds, but very high risk securities. But it's a new method for governments or to raise funding for projects which have positive social impact. Right? Moving ahead. Here you can see some details about it. I think we have discussed most of it. Type of social security provides capital to public sector to fund the projects that create better social outcomes. Public-private partnerships, social impact bonds, they were recently talked about in an article in Livemint, in one editorial. A public-private partnership, obviously because the private sector is providing money to the public sector. That allows private investors. Okay. UK-based Social Finance Limited introduced the first social impact bonds in 2010. So social impact bonds come with high risk for investors, as I just told you, intended to help align interest of different entities including government, investors, social enterprises to develop effective solutions for public sector problems. Repayment of the bonds depends upon the success of the project that has been subsidized using the bonds. So since we're talking about social impact bonds, guys, there is a concept of social stock exchanges also. So I would like you to study a little bit about these social stock exchanges or social exchanges. How do they work, or what is their stage of development, right? So I hope you will learn about it and mention some amazing details about it in the comments, right? So I'll wait for your answers. Moving ahead to the next question. So here is your fourth question for today, which says dash is a situation where future price of a commodity is higher than a spot price. Very simple question. Moving ahead to the solution, and the solution says the correct option is option E. Option E means contango. Contango is a situation where the future prices of a commodity is higher than the spot price. Now let us first discuss what is spot price and what is a future price, right? So if you want to buy a commodity now, the price that you have to pay is known as spot price. So you are dealing in that object, in that particular commodity now, you are getting the ownership hand to hand. But what price you would have to pay if you want to buy that commodity in future, that is known as future price. Very simple question. Let's say there is a company called A Limited, and this A Limited, this one share of A Limited is valued at rupees 100, right? Now you expect this to rise in future, right? But you're not very sure about it, so you are a little bit dicey that whether I should go for buying it now or not. So if you want to buy it now, you have to pay rupees 100. But let's say your dealer says that if you want to buy it after 3 months, that means you want to buy a 3 month futures contract, then you would have to pay rupees 110. So 110 is the future price if you want to indulge into an agreement which will allow you to buy the commodity after 3 months. That is going to be 110. And if you think that the price of this share is going to soar even more than 110, then you would want to invest into it because you are still going to make profit, right? So difference between spot price and future price, very simple, right? Now when the future price of a commodity is higher than the spot price, then this situation is known as contango. So this can be opposite also. This might be priced at rupees 90. If investors expect that the future price is going, if in future the price of the stock is going to fall, it might be 90. It's not necessary that they should be higher, right? So if you remember what happened with oil price in April, when it went into the negative territory, it was not the spot price, but it was the price of the futures agreement, right? It was the futures price. So simple question, contango happens, future price higher than the spot price. Moving ahead, and yes, backwardation, the opposite of it, when future price is lesser than the spot price, then it is known as backwardation. Contango is sometimes also called forwardation, right? Moving ahead, some more details about contango. Situation where future prices of commodity is higher than the spot price usually occurs when asset price is expected to rise over time, results in an upward sloping forward curve. Contract supply. So on what does it depend? It depends upon the supply and demand affect the future price at each available expiration. So what is the supply of that particular security? What is the demand? They are going to determine the price. In contango, investors are willing to pay more for a commodity in future because they are expecting the prices to go even higher, right? If the investor would have expected that, okay, after 3 months, the price will rise from 100 to 105, but it is not going to go beyond 105, then it might not be fruitful for him to invest in the future contract which is pricing the value, the commodity at 110, right? But if the investor is expecting that it will become 120 after 3 months, then it might be a good option, right? Premium of the current spot price for a particular is expected, is associated with the cost of carry. So this is very important term, cost of carry. It means the cost of storing or the cost of maintaining that particular commodity. If it is very high, then the future prices are going to be high. Because see, you are going to buy that commodity in future, you are going to buy it after, let's say, 3 months. Till then, the investor will have to, the dealer with whom you are dealing, or the dealer selling you the, that particular object, willing to sell you that particular commodity after 3 months, will have to store or maintain that commodity until the tenure of that contract expires, right? So that cost of maintenance will be added in this price that you will have to pay if you want to buy that commodity in future, right? So this has been an important aspect in the case of oil prices going negative as well, right? So guys, I have been referring to this event. This is a very important event. So if you do not know about it, that why did prices fall into the negative territory or what happened, you can ask for its link in the comments, right? Moving ahead to the last question for today, it says, which of the following will disincentivize people to hoard cash rather than put them in banks, right? Five options you have to tell which is going to disincentivize hoarding of cash. Okay, moving ahead to the solution, the solution says that the correct option is option B, that means high rates of deposits provided by bank. So guys, it's a very simple question. See, if there is uncertainty in the economy, or a pandemic has, there is outbreak of a pandemic in the economy, and people do not know what is going to happen in future, then they might want to stack bundles of cashes under their pillows or under their bed sheets, or they might want to keep their cash safe rather than putting it anywhere else, or rather than putting it in banks, because they never know when they would require that cash, right? So whenever there is an uncertainty, we like to cut on our spending, especially us Indians. We have this tendency to store cash, or we believe in liquid cash, right? So if you talk to your parents or people of older generation, they still do not believe in this online culture, online transaction. They believe in holding liquid cash, right? So uncertainty leads to hoarding of cash. After that, low rates of deposit provided by banks. That means if you put your money into bank, your reward is lower since the interest rates are lower. That is why less incentive to invest, to keep your money with the bank. Risk involved in buying assets. So if buying assets is very risky, the prices are going up and down, the market is very volatile, you might not want to invest in an asset. Like, you might not want to buy a property because you know that in future real estate is going to crumble, right? So if there is risk in buying assets, you might want to store your cash with yourself. Expected financial crunch in future. If you expect that there are going to be financial difficulties in future, then you would like to have hard cash with you or liquid cash with you rather than bounding that cash into some sort of investment, right? But this is not the correct option, because if there are high deposit rates which are provided by banks, it is obviously more fruitful to keep your money with the bank rather than storing it at home, right? So very simple question. You can see some facts about it. So recently this has been a known phenomena that during this period of coronavirus, although digital transactions have soared, people have started to transact digitally, because obviously there is fear of spreading the virus or getting the infection if you touch the currency notes, right, which is not there in online transactions. So online transactions, definitely they have soared, but people have hoarded a lot of cash also, right, just because of the factors we just discussed about. As you can see here, 28 October before demonetization, currency with public was 17 trillion, which has become 25.85 trillion as on 25th September. So you can see about a 50% rise in almost 4 years. Disruptions that they have taken place as a fallout of COVID reflected themselves in many ways. One is cash coming back into the economy even as digital transactions continue to rise. So usually they are considered they are not considered complementary in nature, but it is happening, both of them are rising. People are worried about their future, they are cutting back on spending. So people who have money, even they are not willing to spend much money. At least they are not willing to indulge into discretionary spending, right? So we have to buy the necessities such as food or medicines, but things we buy for leisure or such as expensive clothes or cosmetics or expensive sports equipment, whatever is not very really necessary for life, they are not into buying those items too much, right? At the same time, interest rates on saving deposits have come down. So this is also a factor. Banks have lowered their deposit rates. That is why it has become less fruitful to park your money with the banks, right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. If you did, then don't forget to hit that like button, because I'll be back in the next session with some more information that can be of use to you. So till then, you take care of yourselves, keep your studying going on, take the precautions to keep yourself safe from the virus, and I'll see you in the next session. Till then, thank you for being here.